Hey, everybody, it's Bob here, and we've got another episode of The Cast coming up here, and we are here with Jeremy Lurcher from at Sea Key West Fishing Charters. It's kind of a mouthful, but he's got a fishing charter business down in Key West that he does a great job for his clients. And we had a chance to actually go out with Jeremy a couple of weeks ago. We had a great time. And Jeremy, welcome. Glad to have you here.
Hey, how's it going, Bob? Yeah, man. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, a lot of fun. So let me just, I'm looking down at my notes here just so I can keep on track. But so let's just level set how we actually met. We met through a common friend that we both have, right?
Yeah, through Cliff Cody, country music singer.
Yeah, if you guys haven't seen Cliff, Cliff is a country singer, songwriter, actually, extraordinaire, and he's very, very good.
Yeah. And
he's a great guy, and he plays at the Hog's Breath in Key West. And that's how, you know, Jeremy's in Key West, and so that's how we've gotten to know Cliff, and that's how we connected with Jeremy. So there's Cliff right there. He's a great guy, and you got to come down to Key West and you know, show Cliff some love. So I wanted to make sure we got him into the video as well, because that's how we met. So we went out, today is Wednesday as we record this. Actually, I think it was 3 weeks ago today, wasn't it?
Probably. I've been on the boat every day since, so that sounds good.
Yeah, and we had a really fun day on the water. And tell us about, you know, where we went and, you know, kind of how that went. Give people an overview of what we did.
We did a lot of winds blowing stuff off. We did a lot of shallow bottom fishing, tons of red grouper, picked at a bunch of mangrove snapper, yellowtails, lanes, muttons, got into a couple big creatures, fought some big sharks, fought some big live grouper. Cliff wore into one for, I don't know, was that almost an hour?
That was unbelievable, and it's just too bad we couldn't get that thing up, you know, to the surface. We never saw it.
Yeah, never got to see it in 17 feet of water.
Yeah, I don't know whether you say it probably was a big Goliath or it may have been a shark, basically the way.
Big Goliath or a big living shark are probably the two best bets.
And then probably, we think what happened was the whatever it was wrapped itself around a rock, maybe, and that's where it snapped the line, pretty much. But
yeah, that doesn't take much with 30-pound leader.
Yeah, big stuff. Yeah. I felt so badly for Cliff because he fought that thing so valiantly for, you know, 45 minutes, whatever, an hour. And then he had to go play guitar that night. And he made the comment, only slow songs because my forearms are just absolutely spent. So anyway, let me just ask you a few questions, Jeremy. Obviously, you're in the charter business now, but what's your earliest memory? How did you kind of get connected? How did you get the love for fishing?
So my parents ran a tavern along with a bait shop and a boat ramp down in the south side of Tampa Bay in the Little Manatee River. And so I spent summers pretty much either selling shrimp out of the bait shop or fishing off the dock behind the bait shop. And that's kind of how I started into it. And ended up my first 5 years of chartering was right in that same area, the southwest corner of Tampa Bay, southeast corner of Tampa Bay.
Do you remember what, you know, like the first fish you caught or what? Is there a memory of that?
I don't know if it'd be the first fish I ever caught, but the one that I remember, I bet I was probably 9 or 10. And we had some huge sheepheads eating up off the pilings at the dock. And I used an old like Zebco 33 or something small.
Gotta love the Zebco.
and just hooked into one of them and it was, the drag couldn't do anything. I wasn't going anywhere. The fish wasn't going anywhere. And I remember jumping up, grabbing the line and just running down the dock. And eventually the fish just flopped up on the dock. And my buddy netted it while it was on the dock. And that was the first big catch that I remember.
Right. Well, it sounds like your parents had it all dialed in. A tavern, a bait shop, and a boat ramp. Ramp, right?
Yeah.
Jeez Louise, what are we doing, right?
Yeah, no joke.
Now, did you go on family vacations as well and go to different places fishing, or was it pretty much spent, you know, at that place in Tampa?
Yeah, pretty much down there, and then the only vacation we would go is out to like Clearwater Beach or Reddington and fish off the Long Pier out there before we were old enough to drive and have our own little John boats and stuff. But yeah, that was about the only place we'd go on vacation and fish was out there on the coast, Clearwater, St. Pete area.
And then from Tampa, you know, as you kind of grew up and after you went to high school and all of that type of thing, you've got a background that most people would envy in terms of where you've been, where you've guided, you know, the species you've caught. You know, I don't know that there are guides out there that have the sort of the varied resume that you have in terms of places that you've been.
It worked out really good. It was fun. I did a little bit of college and during college got my captain's license and pretty much decided 100% this is what I was going to do and stopped going back to class and started running charters full time in spring of 2000. And I did 3.5 or 4 years in Tampa Bay, got on a guide team with some really good guides and got to really learn the tarpon deal and sort of got into fly fishing a little bit and got the opportunity, got a phone call from a small resort in Little Cayman and their fishing guide had put in his notice, was going back to college and they needed somebody that could teach fly fishing and run an offshore boat at the same time. So jumped on that opportunity, got a 3-month visa and stayed there a little longer than that.
And Little Cayman is just what it is. It's little, and there's not much on it, right?
Very small. Yeah, there's about 180 locals that live there, 5 resorts. And when I say resorts, the biggest one has 40 rooms. So the small ones have 6-7 rooms. Like it's a very small place in the middle of the Caribbean.
So did you stay there, or did you go back and forth to Grand Cayman and live on Grand Cayman while you were there?
No, I lived on Little. Okay. It's about a 35-minute flight, so you live there and you're secluded. It's pretty much everybody rides a bicycle everywhere.
So it looks like it's a longer – so 35-minute flight looks like it's farther than you think by boat.
It's about 100 miles dock to dock.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Okay. Didn't realize that. Yeah. Right. And then, so not 9 years there. So you go for a visa for 3 months and you end up spending 9 years there. That's crazy.
Yeah. So I worked at the first little resort, which was the only fishing lodge then when I got there. And then Hurricane Ivan hit and a lot of stuff changed over that summer. And I ended up going back and going to the biggest resort that didn't have a fishing program, but they had the 40 rooms and 16 or so condos. And they just had a lot more clients. And had no fishing program at all. So I came in there and built the fly fishing for bonefish and got an offshore boat and did the tuna and the wahoo and the mahi and all that stuff for them for the last 7.5 years I was in the islands.
Do you have a memory there about, you know, your big catch, you know, something that stands out? You're out with a client and holy crap.
A lot of good catches there. The first marlin we actually landed is a pretty easy one to bring up. That one, I think I was 0-for-6 to touching one at that point. And early in February, I went out with two couples. And the second couple pretty much just hitched a ride because they couldn't go diving that day and ended up having a pretty memorable day when we hooked into a nice blue marlin, probably 350, maybe 400 pounds. And got a ride to the boat, grabbed the bill, got some good pictures, and watched her swim away. It was pretty epic.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. Still on my bucket list, man. That's something we got to do. You got to put me on one of these days, right?
We don't have a ton of blues here. It's kind of the more the fall thing in Key West. We catch some whites in the summertime. They're nice. Sure. They're a little manageable at the smaller size.
And so from the Caymans, 9 years, you know, you went to Alaska, which is not exactly the career track from somebody who's been spending time in the Caymans, right?
Yeah, it was a pretty weird move, but I like all different kinds of fishing, and I wanted to go from one extreme to the other and learn a complete different skill set while still catching fish. And the only way to really do Alaska is to be there the whole summer. The weather there can be great for 20 minutes and horrible for 10 days. So it's the fishing was awesome and I got to do a lot of really cool stuff, flying into ponds that are fished once a year. Like, it's just crazy stuff.
Sure. And then watching out for bear as well.
Well, yeah, a lot of bears. As soon as the salmon start laying eggs, the grizzlies get active. And the fishing was easy. It was keeping people getting mauled by a grizzly was part of the job. Yeah.
Nice job requirement, right? Keep people alive, right?
Yeah. Bring everybody back. That's the goal.
And then you've got Costa Rica weaved in there as well.
Yeah, that was a little bit while I was in the Caymans after that hurricane. I mentioned Hurricane Ivan. We had a long time rebuilding the resort, and I got the opportunity to go down to Costa Rica for a couple months and actually didn't even do the saltwater. I was guiding Guapote, a cichlid, in Lake Arenal on fly, and there was only one other guy that really did it full-time in this lodge that I knew from a friend of my brother's, and went down that was also pretty crazy, going from the Caymans to a volcano next to me with howler monkeys in the trees was a little different scenery than just the wide open Caribbean, but wasn't there super long. Did get out to saltwater for a week or two and played out there for a little bit in the Pacific, but a whole different deal catching cichlids on fly in the lake that is notorious for the wind kicking up to about 50 miles an hour every day at noon. So it was a morning, wow. Morning day every day.
And then Key West would be, I think, the next stop in your progression, which is where you are now. And so you've been there how long now?
About 8 years, with the 2 summers I was gone in Alaska. But right. Guiding full time, probably a little over 6.5 or so here.
And so of all the experiences, all the places and all of that, is there a favorite, or is it just all on the same level?
I mean, I lived in Little Cayman a long time. It's always going to be one of my homes. I was there a third of my life, really, a quarter of my life now. But the Alaska is always special, too. But the funny thing, Alaska, I was there for spring, summer, and fall. I don't think I would ever want to be there in the wintertime.
Yeah.
I growing up in Tampa, like, I was always probably going to end up in Key West. It was just, that's the shows I watched as a kid, the guys you idolize on TV.
Right.
And so many different opportunities to fish here. I mean, it's like going from the Caymans to Alaska. You can go and deep drop 800 feet of water here, and then the next day you're in 12 inches catching bonefish. Like, it's, and still be 10 miles from my house both places. So.
Right.
It's kind of got all the different opportunities in one location, and it's fishable all 12 months of the year.
Yeah, living the dream, right? Most people would say living the dream. I want to be Jeremy.
It's a cool spot. It's not bad.
What? So let's talk about your guiding business, Jeremy, a little bit. And you're full-time, obviously, there in Key West. And talk about your boat setup.
It's a 30-foot contender, twin 300 Yamahas. It does almost everything other than that 10-12-inch bonefish stuff I was talking about. We'll fish the backcountry in 3, 4, 5 feet of water for tarpon, sharks, cudas, and then also run offshore patrol for mahi and wahoo, tunas. Have a big live well. We can go catch live bait and chum up the reef, get muttons, yellowtail, all that good stuff. It's kind of the premier boat that can do everything. So yesterday, wind kicked up and we were in 20, 21 knot winds, and everybody stays pretty dry, comfortable, nice seat on the back bench here behind me. And just all around good fishable boat that we can fish almost every day of the year. I mean, we get some windy days that they can't do anything in, but yeah. I want to be able to fish most of the days, and this boat will do it.
And guys, I can attest to that, because like I say, I was out there a couple of weeks ago with Jeremy, and big, you know, solid, wide boat, handles the chop really, really well. And I will mention that the twin 300s had that 30-footer at about 45 miles an hour. So the thing can really go as well when you get that thing, you know, you push those throttles forward, right? Yeah. So you got that thing. You told me a little story about you searched all over the place and you found it in Tampa, and a friend of yours, I believe Tampa, a friend of yours actually helped you. Pensacola, sorry. So a friend of yours helped you deliver it to you too.
Yeah. So it was a funny thing. I looked up for the last 18 months. I've tried to find this boat, and being in Key West, it's a long drive to everywhere. So I had 4 or 5 times over last summer that it just fell through. I just couldn't get up to the boat in time before they sold. And a good buddy of mine had heard about this boat and knew the guy that owned it, and pretty much called him, and the boat wasn't for sale. But like in we all say all the time, everything's for sale. And he gave a price that if he got that price, he would sell the boat. And I gave him what he asked.
Yeah.
And within a week or two, we were doing the paperwork, and was lucky enough that he was heading down from Pensacola to Sarasota to do for an auction. And I talked him into bringing the boat without ever seeing it, and did the exchange right there in Sarasota. Yeah, the boat's been in the water and working ever since.
And what kind of equipment, generally speaking, do you have on the boat, you know, for your clients? Rods, reels, you know, as a general rule?
Yeah, so I have a little bit of everything. Mostly the reels are either Shimano or Daiwa. The rods are kind of a mix between Star and Shimano's, and some local, one of the guys here in town custom makes rods, so a lot of us use them because they're specific for certain things that we do, whether it be yellowtailing on the reef with a light tip or a real sturdy deep mutton rod, and with the big Daiwa BGs and Shimano reels with braided line. I mean, you can, from the same setup, you can go from catching yellowtail to a 20-pound black grouper. I mean, you change the leader out, and you change the weight you're using in the hook, and you can catch a lot of stuff with the same gear that we use. We do some really light stuff that's fun too if you're playing with the yellowtails, and sometimes you have to go the very heavy stuff, which Cliff didn't have, and it probably would have helped us.
That's right.
It probably would have helped us. Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. What? So you also have nav on there, and your GPS and your you know, the electronics. Talk about what you have there.
That's all a Simrad setup, good bottom machine, chirp on it. And I recently, I think just before you came with that, I put the Navionics chip into the Simrad. So I've got the shading, the relief shading and everything now, which shows some really good stuff. A lot of places I just fly over at 40 miles an hour now, I'm looking at a lot more and really probing the bottom and it's awesome. I used Garmin for years, and just because every boat I drove had them, and they're really easy to use. And with the Simrads, I mean, do a little studying, watch some YouTube videos, you learn how to use them, and they're awesome. I love them now.
Yeah, and then the other thing that you have that's kind of unique and new that you're, you know, there's others that are trying to catch up to you on this thing, is that big trolling motor on the front of that thing.
Yeah. I knew that was coming up. It's funny. I wouldn't have probably put it on the boat, but because the boat came from Pensacola, where he fished the oil rigs in water that you just can't anchor in, he had it on the boat and rigged. And I actually, while I was bottom painting the boat, thought about building a rack so I could leave the trolling motor at the house until the days that I use it. And now I use it every day. So it's right. It's epic. If we're fishing shallow water, and especially the areas like where we fished, where there's just big, huge coral heads scattered, and you might not stay in the spot for more than 15 or 20 minutes, you start getting a ton of grunts showing up, then it's so much easier to go and pull a 50-pound anchor and 100 feet of line.
Right.
I can just hit the button, take a soft anchor, and turn the trolling motor on, fly over 150, 200 yards, and hit the button again, and we're anchored back up fishing. We lost a total of 3 minutes, where sometimes it's 10 to 15 in your anchor unwedged from a rock or something.
Right.
It's pretty awesome. And then another thing, we fish wrecks in 200 feet of water, and those wrecks are surrounded by sand. If you hit a wrong current or the tide changes and you drag your anchor up under that wreck, you just lost your anchor and chain. It's gone.
Right.
So it's pretty cool. And there are some guys I've already talked to that have them on order. There's going to be more still.
I was gonna mention that too, because you were kind of the first one down there, and now all of a sudden, geez, these trolling motors are showing up on other boats.
Yeah, they're going to show up. Right now, everybody can still see me. There's a lot of this size boat and the size contenders down here, but still the first one with the trolling motor on the bow, and so the guys recognize me from a little ways.
Yeah, exactly. There's Jeremy, and it has to be sort of a longer shaft on that motor as well, because you're. Yeah. You know, the bow of that boat is out of the water a little different than like a your typical bass boat, your typical Ranger or Bass Cat or something like that, where it's lower to the water. So that's one change in the motor that you have versus some of the others.
Yeah, for sure. Sorry, I got a plane going over. We're in between two airports.
Right, yeah, that's
Navy base to the east and U.S. airport to the west.
That's all right. Hey, is there any piece of equipment that you're watching right now that you'd really like to have?
Actually, I just bought a Tanacom 1000 deep drop electric reel that I'm going to use for kite and for deep drop. So I have it spooled up, ready to go. Tomorrow might actually be the first day we play with it. I did a lot more deep drop learning last year during COVID, and we couldn't really run charters, so we were going out and dropping weights down into 600-800 feet of water, and gonna do a lot more of that this summer. If the mahi's a little slow, the trolling bite gets a little boring after 45 minutes of nothing, you can always drop down a weight with a rig and pull up tile fish to snowy groupers to black belly rose fish, like all sorts of good stuff down there deep.
Right, and you mentioned last year just being a tough year for everybody. How did that affect your business? I mean, you couldn't do charters, so I imagine it was you were doing whatever you could to make it work, right?
It was tough for everybody. I mean, they shut down here on St. Patrick's Day, which our season in Key West starts pretty much on Valentine's Day. So we had about a month of normal doing trips every single day. And for us, for fishing guides, normally from about mid-February to 4th of July, we probably make 80% of our income. And with last year, it closed 3 or 4 weeks into that season and then went to completely zero. They put a roadblock up in the Keys, and unless you lived in Monroe County, you couldn't drive down here. So there were not quite 0% charters run, but it wasn't very much. It wasn't every day, that's for sure.
Right. It's basically the locals that are coming out.
Yeah. Right. It was people that lived here that decided to stay for the summer. And when the weather was right, we'd go out and take a couple locals or bartenders, because they had nothing to do either.
Right.
And go commercial fishing and just try and make enough to pay for gas.
Yep. So the business side of what you do, the sponsorship side of what you do, you've got some sponsors that you work with, and you know, we obviously have our academy that we teach people about getting sponsors and being better for their sponsors. Talk to me about, you know, how does that work in your life with your business and the sponsorships that you have?
I'm pro staff for a couple companies, which pretty much is the discount on gear like Rapala, Columbia, Smith. And they're companies that I use. I don't really go after stuff I don't use. I've been in it that 20 years. It's kind of something that unless I really use the stuff, I'm not even going to put the effort into to really getting the sponsors or the pro staff designations on them. It's stuff I believe in. Like with Rapala, I the VMC hooks are fantastic.
Yeah.
Smith. My sunglasses, you know, that's all I wear. I've got a bunch of different pairs depending on the day and the conditions. And just Columbia makes good clothes. I mean, there's just that SPF factor. I like a lot of guys. I don't like sunscreen, but down here in the sun, you have to have something on. So long sleeve, the buff. I put some on and face and nose, but if you can cover it up with good clothes and glasses and hats and stuff, then
Yeah.
It's just good stuff. I mean, for as far as reels and rod stuff, I don't really have any specific ones that I'm pro staff with, but, sure.
So the pro staff commitments you do have, what type of time commitment is there? What do you have to do to fulfill that commitment for them?
For the most part, they want some social media covers, hashtags, tags in Facebook and Instagram stuff. They love, when the products are in the pictures and I don't do a ton of video. You know, half the time I'm outside of self-service range when I'm fishing. We're trying to get some good videos. I don't know if you've seen the Mako. I think I showed you the Mako video from maybe a month ago.
Yeah.
That was a pretty epic video we got. And that was with brand new Shimano Speedmasters that I just got like weeks before that. And
what kind of advice? I mean, this is kind of the cliche question, but somebody wants to get into guiding and, you know, do what you do, basically. You know, what are the steps? What would you say? Would you say don't do it? Or would you say here are the steps you gotta take to get into this business? And what are they in a nutshell? Just the Cliff Notes version.
So first I would never tell somebody not to do it. If you love it, if you love it and are okay with beating up your body forever and getting sunburn all the time, give it a try. You have to love it. This is teaching as much as it is fishing. It's you're taking people that don't know what's going on and don't know exactly what you know. And you know that because of time on the water. You have to spend time. There's no way that you can be a great guide in 2 years or in 5 years. And fish with other guides. One of the best things that's happened to me is in Tampa when I was a kid, I fished on a guide team with 9 other guys. In Alaska, same thing. I had 9 other guys at the lodge and we talked every single night, every morning. And you learn stuff from other people. It's hard work, but if you enjoy teaching and taking people fishing, it's definitely something that can be done.
Here's the one question I like to ask Jeremy, and that is the one setup question. So if you had one setup, one rod, reel, line, you know, live bait or a lure, and you had to catch the most species of fish that you could, you know, that's the only thing you could use, what would that be?
Like I was saying, the with the new bigger spinning reels and braid, I'd probably a 5,000 BG with a star medium rod, 7 foot medium rod, in the 15 to 30 pound range, and I feel like you could catch bass on that. You could throw poppers for mahi, and I've done that with that rod. I've caught wahoo on speed jigs on that rod with a wire leader dropping straight down in 250-300 feet of water. Mahi, I mean, you could easily catch a mahi with a 30-pound leader and a number 3 hook on a piece of chunk bait when they get next to the boat. I mean, I've caught king salmon in Alaska on that setup. I mean, you could really that size with the new braids and the drag settings on the reels. I mean, I think that reel you put 25 pounds of drag on that. I don't ever would ever put that much drag on anything. You're just asking to break a hook or test your knots. But the versatility of that size rod, I mean, usually I have 14 to 16 rods on the boat and 8 of them are that combo.
Right. All right. So guys, what Jeremy he's not saying, there's a big event in his life that's coming up very, very soon. And what might that be, Jeremy?
I'm getting married next week.
Hey, yeah. Next week. Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah, you and your bride are a good couple. And, you know, she's obviously supports you in your business. And that's very, very important. And that's a good thing to have.
I'm lucky. Yeah.
Well, congratulations on that. And you know what? Here's my advice. You didn't ask for it, but you're going to get it anyway. The two best words for a marriage. Yes, dear.
Yeah. Gotcha. Thank you, man.
Well, I like that one. Okay. So two final questions, kind of the lightning round. Favorite food.
I mean, it's hard to go with fresh fish, whether you cook it or eat it raw. It doesn't really make a difference. The fresher, the better.
Makes sense. And then favorite music?
Oh, well, it's going to be live country music. I mean, that's pretty much the how we got into this conversation.
That's right.
I know Cliff from going to have, I missed live music in the Caymans for 10 years. So whenever he's here in town, we go and listen to Cliff and have a couple beers.
Yeah. So how can people get in touch with you, and how can people book, a charter with you, Jeremy?
My website has a book now button on it. It's at cqwest.com. And that's the easiest way. Also, I'm on Instagram at CKW. And the Facebook page is at CQWest also.
Well, fantastic. I cannot wait to get back down there and get out on the boat with you and Cliff and whatever other knucklehead we can drag with us.
Yeah.
And have some fun, because we had a great time out there. And I can tell you guys that Jeremy will put you on some fish, and it'll be, you have great equipment. You got a great ride in that 30-foot contender. And Jeremy, I appreciate you coming on with us. This was a lot of fun. I always like talking to you. And like I said, I can't wait to get back on the water with you, buddy.
Yeah, man, it'll be fun. Thanks for having me. It was cool.